You know what time it is. I mean, how many of you know what time it is? If you know what time it is, put your hands together for God. Because this is when yokes are broken. Through his word, that's when anointing shows up. So if you would stand on your feet, I'll be coming out of Genesis 21. You open up your Bibles to Genesis 21. And you know what I do every Sunday. I need you to look your neighbor in the face. Look them in the eyes. Stare at them. Don't stare them down. Just stare at them. And tell them this, to encourage them. No matter how long the delay, God is on time. Put your hands together for God. If you're in Genesis 21, would you meet me at verse 14? I'll be reading Genesis 21, verses 14 through 19, reading out of the New King James Version. And it reads, "So Abraham rose early in the morning and took bread and a skin of water, or bag of water, and putting it on her shoulder, he gave it and the boy to Hagar and sent her away. Then she departed and wandered in the wilderness of Beersheba. And the water in the skin was used up, and she placed the boy under one of the shrubs. Then she went and sat down across from him at a distance of about a bow shot, which is around 100 yards. For she said to her, self, let me not see the death of the boy. So she sat opposite him and lifted her voice and wept. And God heard the voice of the lad. The angel of the Lord called to Hagar out of heaven and said to her, what ails you, Hagar? Fear not, for God has heard the voice of the lad where he is. Arise, lift up the lad and hold him with your hand, for I will make him a great nation. Then God opened her eyes and she saw a well of water, and she went and filled the skin with water and gave the lad a drink." My controlling thought for you this morning is when God steps in. And it will be coming from the sub-thought of rejection overruled. You can take your seats. Lord, I honor you in this place. I worship you and I adore you. I cast all my love before you, God, thanking you for who you are. I come to this place acknowledging and admitting that we all are helpless without you. We need your Holy Spirit and your word, God. We need it to guide us in the right path. Lord, I asked you in this moment that you may take my head and take my heart and speak through my mind and my mouth. Let there be no gap between my will and your words. We invite you and we invoke your presence, God. Speak to your children right now because we're listening, Father. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen. I grew up being forced, although indirectly, watching a lot of football because my dad controlled the remote control. And when he got his man cave, you could still hear the reverberation of the game from upstairs, which drove my mom crazy. Well, during that time that I was growing up, there was this amazingly talented running back who played for the Chicago Bulls. He was jersey number 34. He was a three-time NFL MVP, Hall of Famer, Super Bowl MVP of 1985, my graduation year. And his name was Walter Payton. And one of the most memorable things about Walter Payton, beyond the accolades that I just shared with you, was whenever Walter Payton got hit, and he took some vicious hits, the first thing he would do is jump up and run back to the huddle. No matter how hard they hit him, he would jump up and run back to the huddle. You never saw Walter Payton limp back to the huddle. You never saw him lay down on the ground after a hit. No matter what, he would jump up and run back to the huddle. When they induct him into the NFL Hall of Fame, one of the sports writers that was interviewing him asked him this question. I know you have been hit hard. So why is it that whenever you got hit, you would jump up and run back to the huddle? And this is what Walter Payton said. He said, I jumped up and ran back to the huddle because I had to make sure that the one who hit me didn't think he hurt me. And even if I got to fake it, I'm going to make certain that they know they didn't hit me hard enough to keep me down. I don't know who I came here to talk to this Mother's Day morning, but I come by here to tell somebody that's been knocked down and rejected to jump yourself up and keep running in life, to show them that they can hit you hard, but they can't keep you down. I just come by here this morning to tell somebody who has been rejected to jump yourself up and run back and keep on going in this world. Mama, brush that stuff off. Don't let them think that they got the best of you. Girl, go get your hair done. Get those nails done. Get back into the gym. Close the doors of those backstabbers. Deep six those liars and keep on moving in God. See, they may knock you down. They may reject you, but don't sweat it. That's when God will step in. He will put his stamp of approval on you and pronounce rejection overruled. The Bible is a book of hope. It is a book filled with stories of love, of power, of faith, of glory, and of sacrifice. It is a book with a message of grace and peace and salvation, redemption and miracles. Yet, the Bible is also a book filled with impossible situations. Yet time after time, each one of those impossible situations are handled with ease by the love of a sovereign God. One of these stories, which is connected to us today in this text, is this story of this triangle between Abraham, Sarah, and Sarah's slave, Hagar. Here, the story begins in Genesis 12, where Abraham, or at that time, Abram, is promised by God that he will have a seed, a son, who will become the heir of a great nation. Abram is getting older and Sarai, his wife, is getting past the age of childbearing. And the promise is not yet been fulfilled. So Abram has a promise, but Sarah has a problem. She's been barren all of her life. And because she has a problem, like most of us women, she comes up with a plan. But isn't it amazing that when God's promises meet our problems, we start planning? we start helping God out. And whenever we start helping God out, we mess things up. Because like Abram and Sarai, we become impatient with God's delay. But we must know that God's delay is no indication of his denial. Because God does not move according to our timing does not mean that God will not show up on time. God is not delaying things just to delay things. Sometimes he's delaying things as an opportunity to develop your character for the next thing. That is why we must respond to God's delays with appreciation and not agitation. That's why we must develop trust for more than just God's character. We must develop trust for God's timing. So here is Sarai in Genesis chapter 16 with her plan. She tells Abram to take her maidservant, her slave, Hagar, an Egyptian woman, as a wife, and go in and sleep with her. And without any persuasion or contemplation, Abram readily agrees. And Hagar conceives. And now Sarai, who hatched the plan in the first place, is now having problems with Hagar. She doesn't like how Hagar is treating her. So Sarai gets mad at Abram and tells him, "It's all your fault. Because Hagar despises me now." The term despise in this context kind of means to be brought down. So what Sarai's problem is that Hagar, who is her slave, is no longer looking up to Sarai as her master. Sarai has lost privilege in Hagar's eyes. So Hagar is looking at her eye to eye, which means one of two things has happened. Either Hagar has disrespected Sarai and brought her to slave level, or, which is the most probable, Hagar has reevaluated who she is based off what she's carrying, so she has elevated herself to Sarah's level. And Sarah's not having it. Hagar is willingly provoking Sarai, because sometimes when you are blessed, you don't know how to handle the blessing. It's all right to be empowered. Just make sure your immaturity doesn't show up and abuse the power that you have. So Hagar is in her newfound privilege. Looks in the mirror and says, "You know what? I'm not going to be treated like no slave no more, because I see something in me that Sarah doesn't see." And sister, I came by to tell you this morning that there's going to come a moment in your life that every woman, when she must see something in herself that nobody else ever sees. She must believe in herself like nobody else ever believed. She's got to embrace herself like no one else has ever embraced her. Sister, there comes a moment in your life where you got to have a Hagar moment. A moment when you know who you are. A moment when you don't need some brother to tell you you look good. You don't need some man to tell you you got it going on. There comes a moment when you have to look in the mirror and tell yourself, "Yes, I got it on. I got it going on." Tell yourself how fine you are. Tell yourself, "I'm all that in a bag of chips." Tell yourself that I'm fearfully and wonderfully made in the image of God. Is there any sister in this house who knows who you are? Hagar has evaluated her self-awareness. And watch what happens. The Bible says that Sarai begins to mistreat Hagar. And Hagar leaves. Listen, Hagar knows who she is. And when she gets tired of Sarai mistreating her, Hagar bounces. Hagar escapes to the wilderness and God meets her there. And three things happen. Number one, he gives her a prophecy that is much like the one that he gave Abraham, that she will have a son and she will have many descendants. Number two, Hagar names God. She is the only person in the Bible that has ever given God a name. Others have named the place that they met God, but no one has ever named God. She names him Elroy, not Leroy, Elroy, the God that sees. Hagar declares, I've seen the one who sees me. I've seen the one who sees my suffering, who sees my pain, who sees my misfortune. She sees God and she lives. And now she's found out that God can keep me from the things that should have killed me, that God protects me, that God shields me, that God shelters me. And there is nothing like a woman who knows that God will take care of her. Because a real woman of God who knows that God will take care of her won't deal with a lot of nonsense. A real woman of God that knows that God will take care of her won't beg you for a daggone thing. A real woman of God who knows that God will take care of her won't lay down to get her rent paid. A real woman of God who knows that God will take care of her will not let you treat her any old kind of way. Because a real woman of God knows who she is in God. So Hagar flees, but God intervenes. She sees God, and he gives her a prophecy. And number three, she obeys God. The Bible says, the angel of the Lord said to Hagar, return to your mistress and submit under her hand. And Hagar does exactly what God tells her to do. She encounters God, and because of her encounter with God, she is willing to submit to whatever God tells her to do, even though she knows who she must submit to. What a testimony of obedience. That's probably why she receives such a great promise. So God sends Hagar back to Sarai, back into the storm, back to her oppressor. But he doesn't send her back the same way. He sends her back equipped with a promise of a son and a great nation, and a conviction that when others treat you bad, when others try to make you feel less than what you are, God's got you. So now, let's fast forward 14 years later to Genesis 21. God has changed the name of Abram is now Abraham, and Sarai is now Sarah. And God has now opened Sarah's womb. And God fulfills his promise. And he does it to do this, to prove to them that God has the power over old men, barren women, and long forgotten promises. And despite their plan to get ahead of God, his plan for them still comes to pass. That all along, they got the good news. And I want you to know, to somebody I'm speaking in here today, to today, because you thought that your mistake, you thought that your failure, you thought that that wrong decision forfeited God's plan for your life. It may have devoured it, but it did not eliminate his plan, because it will not eliminate the plan that God had already planned for you. So in this text in chapter 21, Isaac is now 3 years old and Ishmael is 17 years old. And they are celebrating Isaac being weaned from his mother. And the Bible says that Ishmael is mocking, or another term that said he's playing with Isaac. And again, Sarah is upset. She's already feeling some kind of way about Hagar anyway for years. And now Ishmael's actions have presented the opportunity that Sarah has been waiting for. And Sarah says to Abraham, get that woman and that child out of here. Her son will not share in the inheritance of my son. And Abraham is distressed about what Sarah has asked him to do, because Ishmael is his son too. So knowing that he's wrestling with this, God shows up and speaks to Abram and says, don't worry, don't get upset. I won't leave Hagar and Ishmael unprotected. I will provide for them. Listen to Sarah. But wait, wasn't it a problem with God that he listened to Sarah in the first place 14 years ago? Back in chapter 16, and now God is telling him to listen to Sarah. But here's the reason why. Because although Sarah's motivation behind what she said was wrong, the principle behind it, her request, is in alignment with the Spirit of God. Because when it comes to the ways of God, the flesh cannot inherit the things of God. That's why God's plan and your plan can't coexist. The Spirit of God's promise, which was Isaac, cannot exist with the flesh of man's provision, Ishmael. Paul writes it this way in Galatians 5:17. For the flesh desires what is contrary to the Spirit, and the Spirit what is contrary to the flesh. They are in conflict or at odds with each other, so that you are not to do whatever you want to do. So Paul's instruction is validated by God's action of telling Abram to listen to Sarah. Because God is saying, stop settling for Ishmael when I have given you Isaac. Stop compromising your faith for your flesh. Stop settling for less when you can have my very best. Stop accepting the natural way of doing things and foregoing the supernatural. Stop embracing and getting comfortable with Ishmael, fleshly solutions to your finances, to your relationships, to your health problems, to your marital problems, to your child rearing, to your job situation, to your unforgiveness, to your bitterness, and have faith enough to walk in an Isaac solution, a supernatural, spirit-filled solution. Because anything that God tells us to get or to let go of in our flesh, he says it for us to do it out of obedience to him. And that is only a precursor for the next thing that God is going to tell you to do, to walk with him by faith. Because if Abraham doesn't let go of Ishmael in chapter 21, he won't have the faith to let go of Isaac in chapter 22. If you can't let go of the first thing that God tells you to do, you won't be able to walk in his power for the next thing. That's why you need to check your progress on God's blessings in your life. Because God told you to do something years ago and you haven't done it. Could it be it's you and not God holding up your next? So Abraham sends her away. But although they have been rejected, God steps in and he does three things for Hagar. He recovers her from a harsh rejection. He reminds her of his promises, and he reveals to her a hidden resource. So for our first point, he recovers her from a harsh rejection. There is nothing that hurts us more than being rejected. As a matter of fact, having a door slammed closed in your face can alter your mindset. That no matter how old you are, how many seasons of life you have lived through, it doesn't matter what ladder you have climbed in life. At the end of the day, none of us wants to feel rejection. It's something hurtful, and I can even say harmful, when you realize that what you wanted didn't want you, that you applied for it and you didn't get it, that you dreamed about it and it didn't show up, that you prayed about it and it didn't come to pass. I suggest to you on this marvelous Mother's Day that there is at least one saint in this place that is still carrying some baggage from rejection, because rejection brings offense and offense brings bitterness. An author by the name of John Brevere wrote this book, The Bait of Satan. And what John argues is that offense is Satan's number one tool that he uses to detour the body of Christ. Because when you've been offended and you don't get over it, offense will leave the residue of bitterness, and bitterness will create a stain of anger. And you can always tell people who have not gotten over rejection, because even 20 years later, they are still talking about it. As a matter of fact, you can be talking to them about the weather, and then all of a sudden, the conversation will turn some way, somehow, back to how something or someone has rejected them or didn't want them. And you realize in that moment of their anger and bitterness that it's left a stain over their life that continues to show up because they didn't do what Jesus said in Luke chapter 9, verse 5. And this is what Jesus says. He says, "And whoever will not receive you when you go out of the city, shake off the very dust from your feet as a testimony against them." Jesus said, if they don't want you, if they don't receive you, if they sent you a rejection letter, if they won't take you in, if they broke it off with you, when the time to come, when the time comes for you to go, just and to walk out, shake the dust off your feet, brush the residue so that the bitterness doesn't settle on you. Jesus said, don't just do it for their good or your good. Brush it off as a testimony against them. Don't miss that right in the Bible. When you get over it, don't allow it to sit in your spirit. When you refuse to be bitter, you are literally testifying against the one who slammed the door in your face, because they thought that the closed door would make you lie down and die. They thought the rejection letter would make you give up and quit. They thought saying no would make you throw in the towel. But when you get over it and you keep living your life, when you continue to press through rejection, you are ultimately saying to the one who rejected you, you can't stop what God has put in me. You won't block what God has for me. You won't have the final say over me. So here in verse 14, Hagar faces a harsh rejection. They've been kicked out of their comfort. They have been thrown out in the streets. A mother and a son lost in the wilderness, going in circles because of the position they were put in. Two people rejected, sent away by a man who they spent 17 years with and trusted would take care of them, has now sent them away. But listen, we know in verse 13 that Abram Abraham didn't want to send them away, but God told him to. What happens when God's ways disappoint? What happens when God allows others to do you wrong? When they leave you stuck and you're left in a bad situation? Have you ever been there, caught between a rock and a hard place with no way out? You can't get over it. You can't go under it. You can't get around it. You can only go through it. Because there are times that the things that happened in our lives or have not happened to from us, but it had to do with the person that we are connected to. That when we must remember the things that go on in our lives, we have to remember that they are not just for us, that God is using it to demonstrate his power through us. Joseph said it like this: you meant it for evil, but God has meant it for good. So Abraham sends them away some bread with some bread and a bag of water, which in verse 15 we know runs out. And at first, I had a problem with this. Yeah, because Abraham got a lot of money. So I had a problem with this, with him sending them away with limited provision to provide for them. But the more that I spent with the text, the Spirit of God spoke to me that Abram's action was rooted in mercy. Abraham knew God. He spent time with God. He has become acquainted with the ways of God. And God promised that he would take care of Ishmael and Hagar. So Abraham did not release them to die in the wilderness. No, he was giving them up into the sovereign hand of God. So here is the mercy. Since Abraham already experienced that God is faithful to perform his promises, no matter how long you must wait on them, could it be that Abraham knew that if he gave them a little, the quicker they would run out and the sooner God would step in? That when his provision for them ran out, God's provision would pour in. Because when you come to the end of your resources, the end of your strength, that's when God will show up. Isaiah 40, 29 says, he gives power to the weak and to those who have no might. He increases their strength. So when you can't go back, but you don't have the strength to move forward, God will show up. When you're confused and you don't find it hard to hold it together, God will show up. When you're struggling to hold on and you can't see your way through, God will so show up. So if you are waiting on God to show up, to change something in your life, here is a news flash. God is waiting on you to run out of self-provision, to become empty and depleted of self-advancement and become completely dependent on him. Because the trust you put in your strength is overrated. Sisters, I know the world tells us to be every woman, to hustle for the next. But God says what we should be striving for is weakness. Because it is not until you are made, we are made, it's not, sorry, until then are we made strong so that you can learn or lean more into more of God and less of you. That until you exhausted all of your maneuvers and all of your schemes and all your ingenuity and become dependent on him, then and only then will God step in. Not only does God recover her from a harsh rejection, but when she's facing a hopeless reality, God will remind her of his promises. Here in verse 17 through 18, God visits Hagar after hearing Ishmael's cry and reminds Hagar of the promise that he has given her in chapter 16 about her and her child. So Hagar takes Ishmael and puts him under a shrub or a bush for shelter. And the Bible says she goes away from him far enough to not see him or hear him cry because she can't stand to watch the child die in her presence. So she puts some distance between herself and her child. She couldn't bear to see her child in the state that he was in. She couldn't bear watching him spiral out of control. She couldn't bear to watch him wrestle with that addiction. She couldn't bear to see his dreams and his hopes for the child fade away and the promises of God not come to pass. Because mama, when you've done all you know to do for them, you must give them over to God. You must trust in the moments of desperation that what you have placed in them will come out of them. And then you must do what Hagar did. And that, although she turned away from her child, she turned her face towards God. And when she cried out to God in prayer, her child cried out too. And in verse 17, it says she wept, but God heard the child. She couldn't hear him, but God heard him. This is key because the name Ishmael means God hears. I need to tell somebody something in here this morning. If you've been praying and it looks like no answers are coming, I need you to think about Ishmael. Think about the fact that God hears. See, the reason some of us don't shout right there is because we don't just want God or need God to hear. We want God to do it now. Hagar is in the wilderness again, wondering if the God she named, he sees me, sees her pain like he saw her before. He showed up before. Will he then show up again? He turned it around before, but will he turn it around again? He healed me before, but will he heal me again? Will he give me an encore? Will he do it again? But here is the rub. We want God to show up in the same way as before. But God wants to stretch our faith. He wants us to see if we really trust his word, trust that if he did it before, that he would do it again. He just won't do it the same way. I need to increase your faith for the next level. The last time he came to Hagar is because of what he saw. This time it's because of what he heard. So he's going to take them. And what he's telling them is that this time it's going to take more suffering. It's going to take more trials. It's going to take more heartbreak. It's going to take more setbacks. It's going to take some more rejection. It's going to take you being out there by yourself and nobody else can rescue you or hear you. But God wants you to know, I hear you. I'm listening. That even when you've been put out, even when you've been chased away, even when nobody else is listening, Ishmael testifies, God hears. And that won't bring you comfort until your back is up against the wall. That won't make you shout until your pillow is soaked with tears. That won't bring you joy until you hit rock bottom and you pray and nobody else is paying attention to you. But Ishmael reminds us God hears. And I don't know about you, mama, but I am comforted by that. I'm renewed by that, that even though I don't see him, he sees me. Even though my pain clogs my ears, and from hearing him, he hears me. When my child is hungry and I don't know where the next meal is coming from, God hears. When my child gets locked up and I don't have the money to bail them out, God hears me. When my man walks out and leaves me to take care of everything, God hears me. And no matter how abandoned you feel, no matter how cold your situation, no matter how bitter your wilderness, God wants you to know Hagar has proclaimed it. Ishmael represented. I see you and I hear you. And you must know this, that where they dropped you, God will recover you. And when they face hopeless realities, God wants you to know, I'm going to remind you of my promises. Hagar's in pain. And the angel of God says, what ails you, Hagar? In other words, what's wrong with you? Didn't I tell you when he was in your womb that he would be that I would produce a great nation through him? Didn't I already give you a promise? But when you are in pain, you can't always remember what God has promised. So God steps in to remind you, because pain can distort or disorient you. The answer, the solution is right in front of you, closer than you think, but you can't see it because you're in pain. You have been ignored. You have been rejected by folks who are supposed to love you. You've been pushed around by people who are supposed to be on your side. You've been talked about by folks who went out of their way. You went out of your way to help. You've been maligned and criticized, lied on by people that if it weren't for you taking care of them, they don't know you, they would not be where they are. And that kind of backlash, that purposeful deception, is painful, it's hurtful, and it's heartbreaking. That's why, saints, we need to call pain what it is. Stop talking about, I'm not going to claim it. You don't have to claim pain. It's coming. And pain doesn't need your permission. And your faith in God will not stop it. Ask Jesus. His faith was great, and his pain was even greater. Because God uses pain as a tool to groom you, to mature you, to grow you, and to perfect you. Because there are times when God won't remove the problem. He just changes you in the midst of it. He won't change the situation. He just strengthens you in the midst of it. I wish I had some mamas in this house who's been through some seasons of distress in your life. And you can testify that you are stronger Christian now because you went through some the stuff that you went through. You are of a bigger prayer life now because you're stronger than you used to be. Because your thirst for God is more than it used to be. You have a greater determination to live for God now because of the stuff you have been through. Because if you had not been through the struggles that you have been through, you would not be able to call on God the way that you do. God, you don't have to move the mountain, but I need you to give me strength to climb the mountain. Lord, you don't have to move away the stumbling blocks, but I need you to navigate me through it. God, I'm only asking you that you would just keep me through it. Isaiah 43, he said, when I pass through the waters, be with me. When I pass through the rivers, don't let them sweep over me. When I walk through the fire. Don't let it consume me. God, I thank you for the mountains. God, I thank you for the valleys. God, I thank you for the storms that you brought me through. Because if I never had a problem, I never know that you could solve them. I've learned, like Paul, that whatever state that I am in, whether I'm abased or whether I abound, whether I'm hurt or whether I'm happy, whether I'm depleted or whether I'm full, whether I'm disappointed or whether I'm satisfied, I'm going to put all my eggs in one basket. I'm going to trust solely in the Lord. David has this on lock in the book of Psalms. This is what he said. He said in Psalms 56, in God I have put my trust. I will not be afraid. What can man do unto me? He said in Psalms 118, it is better for me to trust in the Lord than to put confidence in man. He said in Psalms 13, but I have trusted in the steadfast love. My heart shall rejoice in your salvation. He said in Psalms 37, commit your way to the Lord. Trust in him and he will act. Then David takes those psalms and he passes it on to his son and said in Proverbs 3, verses 5, trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not unto your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him and he'll direct your path. Mama, what will you pass on to your children? When God steps in and you have to recover from harsh rejections, when he steps in and reminds you of your promises, will you turn to your children and say, I've been rejected. I've been through the storm. I've had my heart broken. I had to cry in the midnight hour. But when I called on the Lord, he heard my cry. And I will put my trust in God because he will step in. Pass it to your children. Not only does God step in to recover you through harsh rejection, not only does God step in hopeless realities to remind you of his promises, but in this last point, God will step in to resources that have been hidden. Saints, if the Lord is going to develop you into the image of Christ, which is why he saved you in the first place, he will do so through the events in your life. He will send you exactly what it will take to transform you into the person he saved you to be. Ask Paul on the road of Damascus. Ask Peter in the courtyard with the girl when he tried to when he denied Christ. Ask Joseph when he was in the pit and in Potiphar's house and then in a prison. God will send exactly what you need. And while you are in it, it won't feel good, but God will use it for your good, to strengthen you for the next. So in verse 19, God opens Hagar's eyes. As I stated, pain can make you forget about the promise. Yes, trouble can make you think that God has walked off and left you. Situations will arise in your life that makes it look like God is not on your side. But I want you to know this morning, sisters and brothers, if you give God a chance, he will open your eyes. And he will reveal hidden resources that in the midst of recovering from a harsh rejection in the midst of reminding you of his promises when you face hopeless realities. God opens Hagar's eyes to reveal a hidden resource. Hagar not only saw the depletion of the resources that Abraham gave her, but God opened her eyes to see the greatness of his provision for her, because God's got more than a bag. God's got a well. Man can never give you what God can give you. Stop crying over that bag when God has given you a well. Stop settling for paper plate love easily tossed away when God offers you fine china, a love that appreciates over time. I need somebody here who needs something from the Lord this morning. I'm not talking about us in here who's self-sufficient and self-assured and conceited in our own resources. No, I'm talking about some of us here who need something from God, the Lord, from the Lord that money cannot buy. Those who need something from the Lord that no number of resources in your hands will supplement. Those who need something from the Lord right now that can't get unless you have God, or unless God delivers it. We need mercy right now. And I don't have enough money to pay for that. We need grace right now. And I don't have enough important people in my life to supply that. We need God to wake us up in the morning. And I don't care what college you went to, what degree behind your name, you can't wake yourself up in the morning. You need God to do that. I need God to walk with me through the valley of the shadow of death. I need God, who is able to do exceedingly and abundantly above all that I could ever ask or think. I need God, who is able to keep me from stumbling. I need God to stand right by my side and make a way out of no way. I need God to straighten up what is crooked in my life, whatever crooked situation that is before me. Is there anybody here that knows that God will reveal it? He will open your eyes to some hidden resources. He will show up in the dark times of your life. You gotta face some situations in a couple of days. You have some mess going on in your family right now. Whatever it is, God will reveal a hidden resource. God told Abraham to send her away. Abraham sent her away with a bag of water. But God opened her eyes and she saw a well of water. Because not only will he give you what you need, he will give you more than you need, more than enough. If you trust and never doubt, God will bring you out. Somebody ought to help me testify. He'll protect you. He'll direct you. He'll lead you. He'll take care of you. He will show up. He will turn it around. He will open the door. He will heal your body. He will dry your tears. He will save your soul. I had to have some harsh rejection. I've had some hopeless realities, but I thank God he's revealed some hidden resources. Won't he do it? Won't he do it? Here's how I know he'll do it. One Friday on a hill called Calvary, he died. But on Sunday morning, he got up to prove that he can do it. He got up with all power in his hands. So, Mama, let me encourage you on this marvelous Mother's Day. Life might get you down, but just hold on. You may have to cry sometimes, but just hold on. It may look bad right now,
but just hold on. It may look like it won't turn out or turn around right now, but just hold on. Because sooner or later, in the nick of time, God will step in. Not sometime, but on time. So in my closing, I'll close with this. Jeremiah said it like this. Through the Lord's mercies, we are not consumed, because his compassions fail not. Now, the question you ought to be asking yourself is, how is it that the compassions and the mercies of God have never run out? That despite how ratchet we lived our lives and how many times we've let God down and how many times we disobeyed God and enjoyed walking in darkness, God has said, my compassions, my mercies have not failed. That no matter what you do, God is always willing to forgive you. And the best way that I can explain this about his mercies never running out is this. When my son, Carlton, wanted to start building his credit, we had a conversation about credit cards and the credit score, or the importance of it. In simplistic terms, though, the credit score is your adult report card. It is the world's way of telling you how well you're doing with your resources. So I shared that with him about the difference between two types of cards that I had. I had a MasterCard and an American Express card. That's all he needed to know. I had two cards. And the best way I could explain it was that the MasterCard has a limit, but the American Express I had didn't have a limit, because the American Express card doesn't care if you charge what you charge. So you can put anything on it, no matter the amount. And my son's eyes got big. And I said, hold on before you take that out of context. I said, the MasterCard has a limit because it allows you to pay it off over time. But the American Express card I have has no limit because they want you to pay it at the end of the month. The only way that you can have no limit is because it must be paid in full. The only way that you can charge whatever you want on it is because it has to be paid in full. You want to know why the compassions of God never runs out? Because like the hymn writer wrote, Jesus paid it all. That when Jesus died on the cross of Calvary, he gave God the American Express for your sins. And no matter what believers charge on it, it's already been paid in full. It's not because you're righteous. It's because the blood still works. It's not because you got it all together. It's because his compassions fail not. It's because God steps in. Great is your faithfulness, God. God never fails. God will step in. And when he does it, he'll say, rejection overruled.